Okay, so I'm gonna start my second lecture on stability result for geometric inequalities. So let me recall last thing we did yesterday was about Fouglede result. So we are in the following situation. We have a set E which has the same measure as the unit ball. And we assume that E can be parameterized with respect to the sphere. So we assume that the boundary of E is of the form omega 1 plus u of omega, where u is a function on the sphere, and u is small as well as its gradient. So u in an infinity plus grad u in an infinity is less than some constant epsilon, which we'll see is universal. And what we want to prove is the following. The perimeter of E minus the perimeter of the unit ball is greater or equal than a constant, which depends on the dimension, times the integral of U squared on the sphere. And actually, well, we'll see that this is not exactly what we are going to prove, because actually this result is false. And a simple way to see that this is false, you just take E. So if this was the unit ball, and we take E just to be a small translation. So, okay, this is a ball. Okay, E was just a translation of the ball. Then, of course, the perimeter of E will be equal to the perimeter of the ball. And so this is not really true. So that's why you must be careful what I'm saying. It's not exactly what we're going to show. So if E was a ball, we are not going to parameterize E with respect to the to a different ball. We have to readjust the barycenter. So there will be a moment where I have to readjust the barycenter to prove this estimate, because otherwise this will be true. So this is true. Modulo a translation of E. So if E were a ball, U would be zero. Okay, and so let's start this proof. I already sketched yesterday very briefly the argument. So the first point is to write down the perimeter in terms of U. Maybe let me just very briefly explain to you where the formula that I wrote yesterday comes from. So the first fact is that the perimeter of E is equal to the integral of square root of 1 plus grad u square over 1 plus u square 1 plus u to the n minus 1, where the gradient means the tangential gradient. U is defined on the sphere, so the gradient you're just differentiating tangentially in the direction of the tangent to the sphere. So where does this formula come from? The idea is the following. I mean, let's say that I have the sphere here, and then I have a path. This is boundary of E. So you have here omega, and this is the point omega plus u of omega times omega. So I'm parameterizing this surface on the sphere. So what you have to compute is the Jacobian of the transformation which maps a piece on the sphere onto the piece of the surface. So what is appearing here is a Jacobian determinant. So you have the map which to omega associates omega plus u of omega times omega. So let's say that I take E1, En minus 1, En minus 1 a basis on the tangent space. Tangent space. So here you have tangent vectors EI. And then you differentiate in the tangential directions. So if you take the derivative of this map of omega, omega is like the identity omega into itself. It's like x. So when you differentiate, you take di, you get ei when you differentiate omega, plus, then you have to differentiate a product. Either the derivative falls here, you get u of omega ei, or the derivative comes here, and you get plus dei of u times omega. So of at the point omega times omega. So this is kind of the partial derivative of this map in the direction di. So this means that if you take the tangent vector ei here and you look where this vector is mapped by the differential of the map, it's going to be mapped in a vector vi, which is this one. So vi, this is just the image by the differential of the map of this vector. And then how do you compute the Jacobian? The easiest way, so the more convenient in general, is just to take a wedge product of the tangent vectors. It's usually the easiest way I know to compute this kind of stuff. So the Jacobian, the Jacobian of the map omega into omega plus u of omega times omega is equal to do the following. You take the image of vi, so you take the image of the different vectors on the basis, you look where they go, so you have these vectors vi, and you take just the wedge product, n minus 1 times, and you compute the modulus of this vector. What happens when you take wedge products of stuff like this? So ei are tangent vectors, are orthogonal. So omega, you see, is a vector on the sphere. So ei and omega, this is an orthonormal basis. So observe that e1, em minus 1, and omega is an orthonormal basis in Arena. So you start to take wedges, so you have... Let me do maybe with just, well, doesn't change much, right? But, so this is what? The first one would be 1 plus u of omega e1 plus v1 omega, v1 u omega. This is the first vector. Wedge. 1 plus u em minus 1 plus... dm minus 1 u omega. And I think this is the last, sorry. 1 plus u plus u, okay, yeah, the parentheses, it's here. Okay. So what happens when you take wedge products? So in some sense, the wedge is multilinear, like the determinant. So the only way you get something non-trivial is that in every step, you have to take different vectors. Like if I take omega 2 times, you get 0 because multilinearity, because of anti-symmetry. So this vector, the only thing, so the only way you get something non-trivial, for instance, is, so this is gonna be, either you take e1, e2, e3, up to em minus 1, so you get, whenever you take all the ei in the product, this is multilinear, right? So I have to start, take one of these two pieces here, then one of these two pieces here, so on, one of these two. So first term I take is the first one, with all the first ones, so I get 1 plus u, m minus 1 times, and I get e1 wedge em minus 1. Then there is the case where I take, one of them I take an omega. So I can take, for instance, let's say e1, and the last one I take omega instead of em minus 1, so I get 1 plus u, 1 time, 2 times, 3 times, m minus 2 times, and then on the last step I don't have it. So I get 1 plus u to the m minus 2. Then at the last time I get d, m minus 1, e, m minus 1 of u. And then I get the wedge product e1, e, n minus 2, omega. And then I keep going like this. So I take, so let me know, for instance, I miss one of the ei and I put omega in place. So you get plus something like 1 plus u m minus 2 dei of u. And then you're going to have e1 wedge At some moment, you're going to miss the EI. So this was the I spot. And then EM minus 1. And the sign could be either plus or minus, depends on the by multilinearity, one of the two. Doesn't matter because we're going to compute the modulus. And this is actually everything you have, because you see that you can never take twice omega. So you can only miss omega one time. If you take two omegas, you get zero. So in fact, you have only this, and all the other terms are zero. So you can try on your own, like, to do a simple case with three vectors, and you will see that these are the only thing you have. So now you have a modulus, and all these vectors are, these are n minus one vectors, are orthogonal to each other. So you just have to take use Pythagoras rule. So what is the norm of this? It's just square root. This is square root of this n minus 1 square plus 1 plus u n minus 2 square times sum over I of DEIU square. And what is this? You take this common factor out, you get 1 plus u n minus 1 square root 1 plus gradius square. This is gradius square. 1 plus u square, which is exactly what I have here. So this is the Jacobian. Again, in case you're not familiar with veg product, a simple way, I mean, you can think in three dimension. You can try to do this computation in three dimension, and then this is just vector product in three dimension. Just A vector B, and you get that third vector, right? So, and in that case, you can convince yourself that what I'm doing is correct. Okay, so this is to justify this formula. Okay, maybe let me just keep going from here. Now, what do we want to do? We want to start to go down, right? We want to estimate this from below. So the first thing I observe is that square root of 1 plus gradius square over 1 plus u square. So remember that u and grad u are small, so I can start to do a kind of a Taylor expansion. This is going to be something like, well, the first order, 1 plus gradius square, 1 plus u square with a factor 1 half. So I put a 2. And this is up to an error epsilon, and which is going to be greater. So u is small as well. So this is really up to 1. So this is really 1 plus 1 minus O of epsilon gradius square. Yeah, that's all. So really, this expression is greater or equal than this over 2. Just use Taylor expansion and to see that this is true. Using that this is small and this is small, bounded by epsilon, both of them. So this is the first bound. And then what about this? 1 plus u to the n minus 1 is equal to 1 plus n minus 1 u plus n minus 1 n minus 2 over 2 u square plus O of epsilon u square. So if I plug in these two estimates in my integral, I get that my perimeter is greater or equal than the integral 1 plus 1 minus O of epsilon gradius square, which multiplies 1 plus n minus 1 u plus n minus 1 n minus 2 over 2 u square plus O of epsilon u square. And now you start to compute products. So you have a bit of time. You have the 1, 1. So this is when you have the 1, 1, so the integral of 1. Then you have this term. So plus 1 minus O of epsilon integral of radius square over 2. Then you have this with 1, so plus n minus 1 u, sorry, n minus 1 integral of u, plus n minus 1 n minus 2 over 2 integral of u square, and then all the rest, which can be bounded by minus, let's say, O epsilon integral of u square, something like this. So this is the kind of estimate we have. Okay? Now, this first term is just the perimeter of the ball. It's the area of the sphere. So we are saying that the perimeter of E is greater or equal than the perimeter of the ball plus this term, there are these other two terms, and then a smaller rest. And what we want to do is to show that this quantity not only is non-negative, but actually controls u square from below, from above. So this is greater than a constant times u square. Okay, so we want u square, so first of all, what about integral of u? So integral of u, we can use the following fact. So what is the volume? So now we have to start to use the volume constraints. So the volume of B1, of volume of E in polar coordinates is the integral over the sphere, the integral from 0 to 1 plus u of omega. So this is in the omega, and this is rho to the n minus 1 d rho, right? Polar coordinates. So this is nothing else than the integral of 1 plus u to the n divided by n over the sphere. Okay? Integral of rho to the n minus 1 from 0 to 1 plus u, it's 1 plus u to the n over n. But this volume must be equal to the volume of B1, and the volume of B1 is the integral on the sphere if you put in the case u equals 0. So integral on Sn minus 1 of 1 over n. Because it corresponds to the case u equals 0. So this means that this integral, the integral of 1 plus u to the power n over n, is equal to the integral of 1 over n. So we are going to expand this term and use that these two terms are equal. So I discover that, so the 1 over n cancels, so I get that 0 is equal, so 1 over n cancels with the first term, so I get the second one, which is u, plus n minus 1 over 2, and then I divide by n, so n minus 1 over 2 integral of u square, plus O of epsilon integral of u square. Okay? So, sometimes maybe I go just fast on this computation, you can recheck them. Okay, so the good thing here, and now that I have a relation between u and u square, which means that here I can substitute, and at the place of integral of u, I can put minus n minus 1 over 2 u square. Okay? So this implies that the perimeter, I go back to my formula, perimeter of E minus perimeter of B1 is greater or equal than 1 plus O of epsilon, well, plus or minus, doesn't matter, integral of radius square over 2. Now, you substitute here this term, and you just put these two terms together. I let you check that you get minus n minus 1 over 2, the integral of u square, minus O of epsilon, integral of u square. Okay? So this just comes using this equation and substituting here. Okay, so this is where we are. Now, as I mentioned yesterday, once you are here, what's the idea? You would like to use some kind of Poincaré inequality, something which tells you that the gradient in L2 controls the function in L2. And here is the Poincaré inequality on the sphere. So let me state it. So Poincaré inequality on this on Sn minus 1. So you want to know if the gradient of u square controls with some constant that I'm going to write in a second the integral of u square. I mean, again, remember what I already mentioned yesterday. In general, an inequality like this cannot be true because if you plug u as a, to be a constant, this is zero, but it's not zero. So you have to kill constants. So if you assume that the integral of u is zero, so if you consider just u, which has zero average, then you have this inequality with the constant n minus 1. Well, it's the same, right? Yeah. I can have it. I mean, if the average is zero, then the integral is zero. In addition, you have you know also when is when you have equality. So equality if and only if u is equal to xi, one of the coordinates, I from 1 to n. So you just take coordinates in Rn. So these are the what I call the first eigenfunction. I mean, after the constant, I mean, the constant u equal 1 is the first eigenfunction, and these are the second eigenfunction on the sphere for the Laplacian. Now, so this is the first one. So what were we saying here? So you have the case u equal 1, which, so you have constants. Now, once you kill constants, you have this inequality. And you, the equality cases are given by these special functions, the coordinate functions. Okay, convex combination of them also, of course. These and any convex combination. Now, if you kill them, so if you say, I want to be orthogonal also to them, then usually you get a better inequality. So it's like, so I'm going to discuss this in a second using spherical harmonics, but the point is this, it's like when you do, just Fourier series. Right, so you have the constant, and then you say you have the first, in the Fourier expansion, the first term is the sinus. But once you're orthogonal to the sinus, sine and cosine, once you're orthogonal to them, then in some sense you get to sine 2x and sine and cosine 2x, and you get a better inequality. The constant improves. So actually what happens is that if you assume here that u not only has zero average, but the integral of uxi is also zero for every I. So you take a u which is L2 orthogonal and L2 both to constants and to the function which saturates this inequality, then you end up with a better constant, 2n. So the constant improves every time. In some sense, every time you kill, you're kind of, you have to think, you are in a Hilbert space, L2, and then you have the space generated by constants, which is a line. You say, okay, if I'm orthogonal, if I remove that line and I go to the orthogonal space in L2, I'm orthogonal to the constant function, then I get an inequality. Since now you have, you say, I know the function which satisfies this inequality, I go orthogonal also to them, and then I end up with the next eigenvalue. So in some sense, you have a matrix, an infinite matrix, and you are killing one by one all the eigenvalues and you're going down. So I'm gonna explain this actually a bit better in a second. But anyhow, these are two informations on the sphere, that you have this and you have this. Now, if you look at the first one, we see that the first one is actually not enough, because here, if you forget O epsilon, and you see that I have a 2, well, let me put the 2 inside, you see that n minus 1 here is exactly n minus 1 there. So the inequality on the sphere, even if u was to be to zero average, this quantity cannot completely absorb this one, because here I have an error also. I have an O epsilon, which goes against me. So the first inequality is not enough for me. So if I want to have a hope, I kind of have to go to this inequality. I want to use this one. And in addition, in my case, I don't have this. In some sense, the only thing I know is this, that integral of u is like integral of u square. Okay, so let me cancel a second this. Hopefully you've wrote it down, and it's not too difficult to remember. Let me see what happens. So in our case, we have two things. The first thing is that the integral of u is equal to minus, so let's say is bounded by a constant integral of u square, which is what I wrote there. But now I can use that u is small. So this is bounded by constant times epsilon integral of modulus of u. And now on the sphere is compact, the L1 norm is controlled by the L2 norm. So this is bounded by constant epsilon the L2 norm of u. So the average of u is a small fraction of the L2 norm. Now, so this is like a way to say that the average, okay, is not zero, but is almost zero. It's very, very small. As I show you a second ago, the average condition is not enough for me because I will get a constant n minus one. I have to go to the next one. So what's the trick now? So the trick of the observation is the following. So E, the boundary of E is parameterized over S n minus 1, but I can, let's say, move E so that some kind of so that the barycenter is the same. Of E is equal is the origin. So there is a small argument here. In some sense, if you have a set which is very close to the sphere, up to some small translation, I can do it in such a way that it matches exactly the origin. And this is not going to change the perimeter. So up to translation, I'm going to assume that this is the case. So without loss of generality, we can assume that the integral over E of the function x is zero. I like to do this computation as an exercise. This is going to exercise that the integral of u times xi is bounded by constant epsilon norm of u L2. So the fact that the barycenter of E is zero and E, the boundary of E is parameterized by u, you can do in polar coordinates and you will see that the scalar product between u and xi is very small for every i. Okay? It's similar to the argument that I did before for the volume and anything. Just write in polar coordinates and compute the integral. Okay, so we have these two informations in our case, that both this guy and this guy are small. Okay, I will come back to this. Maybe let me cancel this for a second. In some sense, our point now is to estimate from below this quantity. So you know that if you have a function on S1, on the circle, so a periodic function, you can expand it in Fourier modes. You have the analogous of this in higher dimension. If you have a function on the sphere, you can expand it in an orthonormal basis in L2, which is given by spherical harmonics. Spherical harmonics are just an orthonormal basis in L2, which are given by eigenfunction of the Laplacian. So on Sn minus 1, so this is just a fact in functional analysis, if you want. Every function in L2 can be written as u equals sum over j and k. Let me just use the same notation, okay? Of some coefficient ajk, yjk, where yjk are functions on the sphere, and they satisfy minus Laplacian of yjk equal a constant, which I think is k, yeah. K plus m minus 2, or minus, yeah, minus 2. Yjk for every j from 1 to some function capital N of k. What am I saying here? So, you can look at the Laplacian on the sphere. And this is a symmetric operator. So then you can look, so you look at this as an operator on L2, this is an Hilbert space, and you can look at these eigenfunctions. So what I'm saying is that for each eigenvalue, so I'm gonna, k is like an index on the, so these are my eigenvalues. So for every eigenvalue, so k is parameterizing my eigenvalues, so this is like my eigenvalue lambda k. For every eigenvalue, I have a set of eigenfunctions, which I'm gonna call y of jk. I have a second index because I have more than one. I can, these are finite. This is kind of, this follows because the operator is compact. There are finitely many eigenfunctions. And the set of all the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian on the sphere forms a complete orthonormal basis in L2. So all this family, which is, so here you have in some sense yjk, which varies over two indices. So k goes from one, is infinite on the, over the natural number, and j goes from one to some capital N of k, which is the dimension of the eigenspace associated to the eigenfunction lambda k. And every function u can be written in this way, and this is an orthonormal basis. So orthonormal basis. And so if you have an orthonormal basis in L2, you can write the L2 norm of U in terms of the Fourier coefficients. So what we have, the first thing is that the L2 norm of U square is the sum of AJK, sum over J and K. Sorry, AJK square, the square of the Fourier coefficients. And if you use that these are eigenfunctions of the Laplacian, it's easy to see that grad U square exercise is the sum J and K of K, K minus, I think about that, plus N minus 2, AJK square. Just, how do you see this? Just compute here the Laplacian. Just use that the integral of grad u square is equal to minus, you integrate by parts, so this is minus the integral of the Laplacian of u times u. And now u, this is the sum ajk. So, okay, let me write down. So this is minus the integral, so you have the first term is Laplacian of u, but Laplacian is linear, so Laplacian is the same. These are numbers, these are functions, so Laplacian enters inside. So this is the sum of j and k of ajk Laplacian of yjk times sum over l and m alm ylm. Okay? And now you use that the Laplacian of yjk is equal to a multiple of yjk. So you just use the formula for the Laplacian. And then you use that they are orthonormal. So the only terms which survive are where j and k is equal to lm. And you get this. So I let you finish the computation, but it's immediate. Just use the fact that these are eigenfunctions. So you have this. So you have these two formulas. Is the analogous on S1, where you have the Fourier coefficients, and here you have sum over k. So just the coefficients, it's k, dimension one. Sorry, k squared, dimension one. Okay. Yeah, now I have doubt on the dimension. No, it's correct. Yeah. And so where are we now? We are here. And let's go back to my information. So we know, so integral of u by assumption in my case is bounded by constant epsilon, norm of u L2. But what is this integral of u? The integral of u, so the key point is that the first eigenfunction, so what is the first eigenvalue? The first eigenvalue is k equals 0, so Laplacian 0. And the functions which have Laplacian 0 on the sphere are constants. So y, actually y, 1, 0 is 1. So this is the first eigenfunction. Well, you have to divide by the measure of the sphere, but let's say it's 1. So what I'm saying here, this is nothing else that a 1, 0 is the first coefficient in my Fourier expansion. Because this exactly corresponds to orthogonality to the first eigenfunction of the sphere, which is the constant. And the second ones, one has to show this, but the second ones are exactly the function that I wrote before. So the integral of xi u being small in L2, well, actually, this y xi are exactly, is nothing else than y i 1. So the coordinate functions are exactly the eigenfunction on the sphere for the next eigenvalue. These, believe me, that these are the first ones. So here, this term is nothing else than the second term in my Fourier expansion. So these are AI1. So here in this Fourier expansion, what do I have? I have A10 square plus sum of A11 square plus the sum for j and k greater or equal than 2 of AJK square. Okay? What am I saying? I'm saying that this term and this term are a very small fraction of the total norm. It's just a fraction epsilon of the total norm. So this means, so what does it mean? So we know A10 square plus sum over I A11 square, it's O of epsilon norm of u L2 square. Which, so this term is just a very small fraction of this. So in particular, this implies that if I look only at this term, so the norm of u in L2 square is bounded by 1 plus constant time epsilon and the sum starting from 2. J k greater or equal than 2, AJK square. In a sense, the only terms which counts in the L2 norm are the coefficients in the Fourier expansion starting from the second one, because the zero and the first are very small. Okay? So this, all the L2 norms is here. So this is a fraction of the L2 norm, but it's almost everything. What about the gradient? The good thing about the gradient, you see, is that there are these coefficients in front. So this coefficient is small. So for k equals 0, this is 0. So it's not very useful. For k equal 1, you get m minus 1. But for k greater than 2, this term is getting bigger and bigger. So in particular, so you observe that k plus m minus 2 is greater or equal than 2n if k greater or equal than 2. And so here the gradient of u L2 square, I say, well, this is greater if I just consider the sum starting from 2, k greater or equal than 2 of this, k plus m minus 2 AJK square. So yeah, forget the first two terms, I don't care. But this is greater than 2n times the sum j and k greater or equal than 2 of AJK square. And this is almost all the L2 norm. You see? Just this sum is almost all controlled to norm up to another epsilon. So this is 2n, 1 plus constant epsilon, norm of u, L2 squared. By this. So this explains also what I said before, but why the Poincaré inequality on the sphere gets better every time you start to kill eigen functions. If u is orthogonal to the constant at zero average, it means that this term is zero. If u is orthogonal also to the xi, it means that all these terms are zero. And so in the Fourier expansion, you have that the L2 norm is exactly equal only to this term, and in the gradient, you can just use that this is greater than 2n, and this is why you get a better constant in the Poincaré inequality. So the L2 norm of the gradient controls the L2 norm of the function with a better constant. And every time you keep the orthogonal to, so in a sense, if you knew that your function was orthogonal also to the next eigen functions, or to the next, let's say, to the spherical harmonic with k equal 2, you will say, okay, let me get rid of the second term, I start from 3, and you get an even better inequality. Okay, so the more you're orthogonal to the eigen function, the better gets the inequality every step. So in our case, here is what we get. And now you see that we are more or less done, because what was the inequality we had before? So our inequality was that the perimeter of E minus the perimeter of B1 is greater or equal than 1 minus constant epsilon integral of gradius square over 2 minus n minus 1 over 2, well, integral of u square over 2 minus of epsilon integral of u square. That was our information. And now we can just apply this inequality to say that this is greater than 2n. Then, okay, 1 plus c epsilon denominator is the same as 1 minus c epsilon denominator, integral of u square over 2, minus n minus 1, integral of u square over 2, minus of epsilon, integral of u square. You see, 2n is greater than n minus 1, so this is, I can say, so 2n minus n minus 1 is n plus 1, and they have a small error, so it's going to be greater than n integral of u square, n over 2 integral of u square, if epsilon is sufficiently small. Is it clear? So you see, I just did, the argument at the end is not that complicated. I mean, I just expanded everything. This is just simple Taylor expansion. At some moment, I used the volume constraint to write everything in terms of u square. I didn't want the terms integral of u. And the key point from this step to this step was to use the fact that by being volume zero, sorry, volume equal to the sphere, so average almost zero, and barycenter constraint, so the two information, integral of u almost zero, and integral of xi u almost zero, gave us this inequality with a very good constant, which was better than this. Okay? So it is normal that we had to do something, remember, because until I didn't fix the barycenter, my set could have been just a translation of a ball. In the case of a translation of a ball, there is no way I can gain something. So it is normal that I had to do something to adjust the barycenter at some moment, because otherwise I would not be able to distinguish, to kind of kill the translations. The translations are my enemies because are the only transformation which do not increase the perimeter. I just take a set, translate it, it's the same. So at some moment I had to kill that. And that was the moment where I fixed the barycenter that I killed kind of the degeneracy of my operator. The perimeter did not increase on that transformation. Okay, once you are here, let me do a simple fact. L2 norm controls L1 norm. So up to constant, maybe you get some measure of the sphere. You get this. And what is this? So here is my sphere, and my set E is some perturbation like this. So you see, this height is u of omega. So the L1 norm of u is controlling exactly these volumes, right? Is exactly this area. And this area is exactly the symmetry that I defined yesterday, the L1 difference between the set and the ball. So this is constant, the difference between E and the ball, and you have a square outside. And so we got the deficit delta controls E delta B1 square, which was exactly what I wanted. And you see that this argument is kind of, I mean, I think this argument already shows that kind of the deepness of the result, because it's already very non-trivial in this setting. I mean, getting this power 2 is already sharp in this very special setting. So the fact that one can get power 1 half all the time is already non-obvious in this setting, so you can imagine that for a general set it's not obvious either. Okay, any questions up to now? The second derivative is not. Yeah, which is behind that Poincaré inequality. Yeah, in some sense, philosophically, you can think about that, this power 2 in the following way. So just to repeat what comment on Bernd. You can think in the following way. I have an infinite dimensional space, the space of sets. And I have a function which is delta V. And here I have the space of balls. So B1 and translations. So my function delta is zero at this point, the deficit. The deficit vanishes on the ball. And then it's non-negative. So delta loop is something like this. This is the graph of delta. And here, so what I want to show is that delta V is greater than a constant, and then a distance, so this is a metric, between E and the space of balls up to translation, and square. That's the kind of estimate we are trying to prove, right? So what I'm saying, but you see that usually, what does it mean this for a function? If you were in a Rn, a function in a Rn, I'm saying that the second derivative, I mean, if you think in a neighborhood, what I'm saying is that the second derivative of my function is positive definite. I'm saying that f of x greater or equal than constant x squared. So my function is uniformly convex near the minimum. So the minimum is non-degenerate. Right? So this is kind of a saying that the Hessian of the delta function of the deficit is strictly positive. It's greater than a constant. That's very philosophical. It doesn't mean anything. But so essentially what we are trying to prove by proving that the constant is, the exponent is one half here or two here, is to say that the Hessian of our function at the minimum is uniformly positive definite. So we have a non-degenerate minimum point. Right? The first non-trivial term in the Taylor expansion is the second one. It's a uniform positive. It's not like 4 power or so on. So it's not flat. Okay. Maybe. Yeah, let's take a break now, and then I will start again in 10 minutes with the next part. Okay, so let me go on with the stability issue. So what we saw is this argument of Fuglede, which proves the sharp stability inequality, power 1 half, in the case of perturbation of the sphere. So we have a W1 infinity perturbation on the sphere, a Lipschitz perturbation. Now I want to show you kind of a different approach to the stability question, which is kind of general. It's going to treat automatically every set, not just perturbation. And then probably either today at the end of the lecture, most likely next time, I will actually show you a different approach to which combined with the Fuglede argument allows to prove the stability inequality for every set. That would be more based on a compactness argument. But in the hour coming, I want to show you just a complete proof of the stability inequality for the superimetric stability result for a superimetric inequality. So my argument is going to be based on optimal transport. Actually, you saw a proof last week by Guido. He showed you how to prove the superimetric inequality using optimal transportation. I'm going to review the proof. And actually, since it doesn't change much, I want to show you that this proof is very flexible and can be used not only for the superimetric inequality, but for what is called the anisotropic superimetric inequality, which is not, it's just going to be a matter of two notations more. But this inequality is very interesting for applications because it's used. It has been introduced by Wolf, a crystallographer, so it's used in the study of crystals. And but mathematically also, it has several interests. So the idea is the following: up to now, we have the superimetric inequality. We started this perimeter, and the minimizer was a ball. Why a ball? Because the ball has the most symmetries. It's the most symmetric set you can think of. Now we're going to change the geometry of our space, and we're going to say, okay, I want to change my ball. My ball up to now was round. I want to take as ball an arbitrary convex set. So I define my new ball in my space. It's like when you take a Banach space. You put a norm. The ball is not anymore round. If you put a different norm, the ball can be different. Okay, so anisotropic isoperimetric inequality. So I'm going to take, let K be a bounded open convex set, which contains the origin. So I have the origin and take K. And now I'm going to say K is my new ball. How do I do this? I want to define kind of a norm for which this is the ball. So to do this, I'm going to define first a dual norm. So I'm going to say that the dual norm of a vector nu, by definition, is the supremum over x in k of x dot nu. This is usually how you define a dual norm in a Banach space. You take the unit ball, and then you define the sup over the unit ball. How do you define your norm? As the dual of the dual. We are defining dimension. So the norm of your x is the sup norm of nu star less or equal than 1 of x dot nu. And if you take this definition, I let you check that k corresponds to the set of points x which have norm strictly less than 1 with this definition. Okay? This is not properly speaking a norm because norm of x and norm of minus x may be different. But apart from that, let me call it a norm. It has triangle inequality, it's one homogeneous, it's positively one homogeneous. So, now, what is the perimeter of a set? So, geometrically, so the perimeter of a set, you can think of this, the classical perimeter. So, for the smooth case, you can take a set E, and then you can take the epsilon neighborhood so you take E epsilon to be the epsilon neighborhood of E or all the points which are a distance of at most epsilon and I mean roughly speaking the perimeter is going to be so if you take the measure of E epsilon, what is this measure? It's going to be the measure of E Then you have a first order term in epsilon, which is the volume of this tube. And this tube at the first order is really proportional to epsilon times the length of this. So this is epsilon times the perimeter of E. And then you have lower order terms. So the perimeter of E, you can think of it as the limit. So perimeter of E is the limit as epsilon goes to zero of E epsilon minus E over epsilon. But what is E epsilon? E epsilon, a way to define it is through what is called the Minkowski sum. So it's, I'm going to say that this is equal to E plus epsilon times B1. So it's nothing else than a set of points of the form X plus Z, where X is in E and Z is in, let me write, epsilon B1. By epsilon B1, I just mean epsilon times B1, which is B epsilon. But it's more convenient to write in this way because I'm going to write epsilon K in a second. So, so this is B epsilon. So I like to check this. So this is the Minkowski sum. By definition, if you have two sets and you do a sum, it exactly means that you start to take all possible sums of points in one and the other. And I like to check that the epsilon neighborhood is exactly the same as this. Because what you're doing is saying for every point x, you're taking a ball of centered x of radius epsilon, and then you do the union of all these balls. That's what I'm doing. And this way you get the epsilon neighborhood of my set, of the set. So this means that the perimeter of epsilon is, for a smooth set at least, is the limit as epsilon goes to zero of E plus epsilon B1 minus E over epsilon. So once you see this definition, you see that to define the perimeter, really, you don't need many things. There is just the Lebesgue measure, and there is the unit ball. So if I say that now, in my case, this is my new unit ball, I can just define a perimeter replacing B1 with K. So what I'm going to do here I'm not going to be as rigorous as I was yesterday with the definition of perimeter as a soup of divergence, blah, 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 because if I want to do the same here, I should start to use theorem about structure of sets of finite perimeter, retifiability of the reduced boundary, blah, blah, blah. So a bunch of technical stuff. So just think that my sets are all smooth, because otherwise we should go through technical results in geometric measure theory. But in some sense, everything can be made rigorous. There is no issue there. So I want to define pk of E, so the perimeter of E depending on k, to be the limit as epsilon goes to zero of E plus epsilon k minus E over epsilon. So in some sense, what you do an epsilon neighborhood, but where the epsilon neighborhood is not anymore measured with the classical Euclidean distance, but with the norm associated to k. And actually, there is a formula for this, which is not trivial to prove. It's in books of convex geometry. That tells you that this is the same as the integral over the boundary of E of the dual norm of the exterior normal. So here you have the set, and here you have nu of E, the unit outer normal, unit Euclidean sense, just classical normal. And then you weight it. You see, the classical perimeter will just be to say put 1 here. The classical perimeter, you integrate 1. Here, instead of you integrate some function of the normal, where this function of the normal is this dual norm. So this means that although this is a unit vector at every point, depending on the direction, because this norm is not the classical norm, depending on the direction, this weight is going to be different. This number is going to be different depending on the point. So it's going to depend at every point on the direction of the normal. So this is my new perimeter. And we have an isoperimetric, so this has been introduced, so this is This perimeter has been introduced by Wolf in 1905. Wolf was a crystallographer, and actually he kind of proved, but as a crystallographer, so say there was not really a mathematical proof, but he said that what is called the Wolf inequality, so the perimeter of a set is greater or equal. So he didn't really prove it, he's kind of claim it. Than this. And here you can recognize the superimetric inequality of yesterday, where I'm just replacing B1 by K. So that's also why yesterday I wrote the inequality in that way, with measure of B1 inside. Because you just replace B1 by K at every step, and you get the anisotropic superimetric inequality. So this is called Wolf inequality. And you have equality if and only if E is equal to K up to translation and dilations. So E is equal to X plus RK. So you take a K, you can dilate it, or you can translate it. Okay, so let me define a deficit associated to this. So these inequalities, of course, are scale invariant. You can always dilate E, but actually you can also dilate K. If you dilate K, this is going to change, but this is going to change in the right way. Otherwise, the inequality will be false. So without loss of generality, just to make things scale 1, I'm going to assume that measure of E equal measure of K equal 1, just to avoid the degeneracy. Now I'm going to define delta K of E to be the error. So to be pk of E minus n. I mean, I copy it, but I could put 1, right? But just to understand what we're saying. So delta k of E is this quantity, which is non-negative. And we're going to define an asymmetry, which is the infimum of the symmetric difference between A and translation of k's, where x is in Rn. So the symmetry is del 1 norm. So here I'm not going to compare anymore A with, oops. So if this is K and this is E, I want to measure del 1 distance between A and K, E and K. And so the question that I want to answer, that I want to address is, do there exist some constant C and K and exponent alpha and K positive such that so A K of E is less or equal than C and K delta K of E alpha and K. Okay? So it's exactly the same as yesterday and just putting K's everywhere. But the question is the same as yesterday. So just so this question has been first investigated in this anisotropic constant context by Esposito, Fusco, e Trombetti. Trombetti in 04, where they proved something like alpha in K goes like 1 over n squared. So they there is an explicit formula that now I don't remember, but they proved that result for some exponent which goes roughly in the dimension as 1 over n squared. And then that's exactly the generalization I mentioned to you yesterday, what we did with Francesco and Aldo, so Maggi and Pratelli. In 2010, what we proved is that alpha and k is always 1 half, and actually c and k can be bounded by something like a number which is less than 200, I don't remember, n to the power something around 11, maybe 9, I don't know, maybe 9, some power. Not different from 9, something like that. So there is the exponent is always 1 half, no matter what is k, and there is a constant which doesn't depend on k, depends only on dimension. Okay, the fact that you get a constant depending on k, it's a small trick of convex geometry. And I think what is most important is the exponent, that we can always get 1 half. And the starting point to study this stability est this test to prove this estimate that I want to show you, it's the proof of the superimetric inequality which was given to you last week by Guido, that I'm gonna repeat right now to show you that it works exactly with no changes in this setting. So last week he gave you a proof of the superimmetric inequality using optimal transport. So let me prove the superimmetric inequality. So I want to prove this anisotropic superimmetric inequality. So proof of isoperimetric inequality. So what the what I guess Guido did was the following. He took a set E and he took the unit ball and he transported E onto the unit ball. So in this case, the ball is not the ball anymore, it's K. So I have my set K, E. How you transport a set to another, you associate to E a probability measure. So I'm going to define mu to be the characteristic function of E over the Lebesgue measure of E dx. So it's a constant density inside E. And I'm going to define nu. Okay, nu. To be characteristic function of K over volume of K dy. Okay. So by optimal transport theory, what we know is the following. If you give me two absolutely continuous probability density, there exists a transport map, so a map T, which is the gradient of phi. So there exists phi convex such that T, the map T, which is defined as the gradient of phi, sends mu onto nu. So this means the push forward of mu to the map T is equal to nu. And in addition, you have this condition gives you a Jacobian identity for T. It tells you that the determinant of the gradient of T is equal, I don't know exactly what you saw last week, but maybe if you have a question, let me know. Now, let me assume that you know this, that you get, I mean, I guess you did it, that you get this number. So this comes from the fact, so why this is true, that the Jacobian determinant of T is this constant. The point is that you're sending a uniform density, so this is a constant density, onto a constant density. So if you send constant density to constant density, the Jacobian must be constant at every point. And the only constant which matches the volume, so you have that the volume of this guy that must be equal. I mean, here you have a renormalization. Since these volumes may not be the same, the only way to get constant density here sent to the constant density here is that if the determinant is this number, because you have a volume, right? I mean, if the volume were the same, you see that you get one. If volume of E and volume of K are the same, you get determinant one. But if you're sending a ball of radius two onto a ball of radius one, the Jacobian will be what? Two to the n. So there is a constant number, and the only possible number is that. So that's the Jacobian determinant. So I'm going to use this result. So let me show you now two properties, actually three properties, of the transport map. So property A, norm of T of X less or equal to 1 for every X in A. Why this is true? Because by definition, K is the unit ball for my norm. So since a point here is sent here, this point, so this is because K is the set of points which have norm less than 1. And my map is sending E onto K. Property B, I'm just gonna copy it, that one. Determinant of grad T equal K over E. So I just recopy that, just to cite it. Then property C. So property C, I guess you already saw this as well, is a property on the divergence of T. So what is the divergence of T? The divergence of T, T is the gradient of phi, so this is the Laplacian of phi. Let me, I'm gonna go a bit fast because I assume you already saw this proof. So this is the, if lambda I are the eigenvalues of the Hessian of phi, this is the sum of the lambda I. Right, Laplacian is the sum of the eigenvalues. And these are non-negative because phi is convex. And so the sum, this is, I can write as n, 1 over n sum of the lambda I. And this is an arithmetic mean of non-negative numbers, this 1 over n. So this is greater than n times the geometric mean of the eigenvalues. And the product of the eigenvalues is the determinant. So this is n, the determinant of my of the Hessian of phi, which is the same as the gradient of t. Okay? Please stop me if you have questions. But you should have seen already this. And so now I can prove the isoperimetric inequality, because and it's actually gonna be just two lines. So PK of E, we say it is the integral of the on the boundary of E of the dual norm of the normal. Now I use property A, so T less or equal to 1, to say that this is greater if I put T. Now, here you have a vector and another vector, norm and dual norm. Norm times dual norm is greater than scalar product because they are the dual norm are defined as sup. So it's greater than the integral of the boundary of T dot nu E. Now, by Stokes, this is the integral over E of the divergence. And now you see greater or equal N integral over E of the determinant of grad T. 1 over n, and then I use b to say that this determinant is k1 over n, e1 over n, and then I have volume of e comes from the integral, and so you get exactly this. Okay. Which is exactly the inequality. So you see the proof is exactly the same. There is no extra difficulty in this anisotropic case. Okay, so here we are. We have a proof, two lines proof. This argument as it is due to Gromov. 99% of something interesting in geometry and deeply is done by Gromov. So let's see. What we want to do now is to make this argument quantitative. So what is delta? Delta k, remember, we want to prove that the deficit controls the symmetry. So what is the deficit? The deficit is this guy minus this guy. So we want to say that if the difference between these two guys is small, then the sets must be close. But if this is small, it means that every time here, I add smallness. So I didn't lose much in these inequalities. and I want to use this information. Every time you want to prove a stability inequality through a proof, you always want to do one check, the quality case. If you have a proof where you don't even, you're not able to use it to prove the quality case, you're not going to be able to use it to prove a stability result which is stronger. So you want from this proof to deduce the quality case at least. This is like step zero. Otherwise, don't start. Okay? Because there is no hope you can prove something stronger if you're not able to do it, at least that. So let's do the step zero first, at least formally. At least you have to do a formal proof. So step zero, equality case. This is kind of a check for yourself. You want to see if you have hope to do more. Equality case. So if delta k of e is zero, it means that from the first to the last step, I didn't lose anything. So this implies that the integral of E or divergence T is equal to n integral of E of determinant of grad T, 1 over n. So this was the sum of the eigen values, and this is the product of the eigen values, 1 over n. So this means that when you apply arithmetic geometric inequality, you don't lose. So the only way you don't lose in arithmetic geometric inequality is if all the numbers are the same. So this is a function of x, because remember, I mean, this depends on the point. So let me put an x to say that these are the eigenvalues at the point x. At every point, you have different eigenvalues. So this implies that you have equality in AMGM for every x, which means that lambda 1 of x is equal to lambda n of x for every x. So all the eigenvalues are equal. But in addition, the product of the lambda I of x, my eigenvalues, is the determinant, and this is k over e. So you see it's a constant independent of the point. So they are all equal, but the product is constant. So this implies that lambda I of x equals some number alpha positive for every x. So all my eigenvalues are all equal, and all equal to the same constant. But this is, what are these? These are the eigenvalues of the Hessian of phi at the point x. So you have a symmetric matrix, which has all the eigenvalues equal to constant. It's a multiple of the identity. So this implies that the Hessian of phi, it's at every point, it's alpha times the identity matrix. But the Hessian of phi, okay, maybe let me, this is the same as the gradient of the transport map. So the gradient of the transport map is the Hessian of phi, and is a multiple of the identity. Alpha, which is a number, times the identity. So I'm saying that my gradient is a multiple of the identity at every point. Particularly, it's constant. So this implies modulo smoothness, whatever, that T of X, so which maps have gradient alpha times identity, is the map alpha of X plus up to a translation. So T of X must be alpha of X plus X dot for some X dot. Let me, I want to keep this argument, so that's why I'm trying to remain there. Okay? Okay, but what we have, we know that T of E is equal to K, because T is sending A onto K. And T of X is equal to alpha of X plus X dot. So this implies that A is K minus X dot over alpha. Okay? So T is mapping E onto A, E onto K. T is translation plus dilation, so the sets were the same. Okay. In particular, if you remember that I assumed, I mean, here I'm not using it, but if you renormalize so that everything is 1, alpha is 1, and you don't have even the constant alpha. Here I'm trying just to, I mean, I'm keeping alpha just to make the argument a bit general here and try to understand what's going on. Okay, so this is good. This is a good starting point. It means that at least the quality case, we can get it. So that's reassuring. We have some hopes. Is it clear, the quality case? At least formally. I'm not saying that I'm trying to make anything rigorous. I mean, I never worried about smoothness, but besides that, I hope it's clear what's going on. Because now we have to make quantitative what I just made, kind of I did in the quality case. So let's go back. Okay, we like this strategy, and in particular, we discover something from the quality case, that one inequality that we want to use is this one, is the fact that from equality here, we had eigenvalues equal, and eigenvalues equal gave us that the matrix was a multiple of that entity here. So now we want to make this quantitative. Like, okay, now things are not going to be equal to zero, but maybe we can say that are almost zero in some sense, are very small. So let's go back now to our problem. Now delta k is not zero anymore, but it's only small. So from the proof, so I want to, so quantitative result. So from the proof, there are two information that I get that I'm going to write down so that then I can also cancel the proof. So one, which is the obvious one to use, that delta k, the error between these controls the difference between these two terms, this minus this. So this, we want to use it. We discover it that is useful. There is a second one, which is, you still don't know that I want to use it, but I know it because I know the proof, which is this one. So I'm going to copy it for my records. So there are two things. So property one that I want to use is that delta k, so this minus this, controls this minus this. Integral over the boundary of E, nu E star, 1 minus norm of T. Second property, delta k of E, is greater or equal than the integral over E. So that minus that is divergence of T. Let me put over N here. Minus determinant of grad T over N. We are not going to worry about constants, so at this stage. Okay? These are two information that I get from the proof. Let's start with the second one, to work with the second one. So here, what is this? This is the sum at every point, is the sum of the lambda I, 1 over n, minus the product of the lambda I, 1 over n. So you have arithmetic mean minus geometric mean. Okay, maybe, and I know, so this is, okay, here I don't want to have alpha popping out, so let me maybe write here in the box. E equal k equal 1, which is going to imply that the determinant of grad t is 1 now. Let me, so that I don't have a strange number around. So now the determinant is 1, because I normalize. So in this quantitative estimate, it's useful that I normalize stuff. Okay, so you have an arithmetic geometric mean. Well, this number is actually 1. And you know that if you have equality, all the numbers are equal to 1. You would like to say some stability result, some quantitative result. Now, this becomes a pure algebraic fact. I mean, it's an exercise, if you want. Non-trivial, but you do it. You can do it. I mean, it's like purely arithmetic. It's a matter of inequality between numbers. That if you have an arithmetic mean minus a geometric mean, this is greater up to a constant. So let me start to put this is up to a constant. To this, the sum over I of lambda I minus 1 square divided by lambda n, where I ordered the eigenvalues by sides. So this is a pointwise inequality. So I'm claiming that if, what I'm claiming is that if you give me n numbers, so if you have 1 over n, sum of ai minus 1 and product of the I equal 1. So if you want, this is greater or equal than sum of ai minus 1 square divided by the max of ai for every ai such that the product of the I, sorry, it's 1. I mean, I'm just writing in small what I just wrote here, actually. So I'm just saying this step from here to here is a pure fact about real numbers. You give me n numbers whose product is 1, and then the arithmetic mean minus 1 controls that quantity up to a constant. The constant, so here there is a constant, which depends on n, so the dimension, because we have n numbers. Okay? So this is a fact. And you can find a proof in the paper, or I can give you a reference, but it is an exercise. So what we know is what then? The delta controls the integral of the sum of the eigenvalues. So these are all functions of x, remember. The eigenvalues depend on x, right? So at every point, we have different eigenvalues. But what we would like to say is that the eigenvalues are close to 1. So here we have this division by a lambda n, which is annoying. How do we get rid of it? Just by order. So this part, it's kind of easy. So what we have is that this, so let me look at this one if you want. Sum over I of lambda I minus 1. This integral over e. This again, this is the same as the integral over e of the sum of lambda I minus 1 divided by square root of lambda n multiplied by square root of lambda n. Why I'm doing this? Because here I want to get something like this. Because now you can say by, you know that a times b is less or equal than epsilon a square plus 1 over epsilon b square for every a and b positive. It's just Young inequality. Or if you want, Cauchy-Schwarz, whatever. So here I can say that this is less than epsilon times this. Sorry, no. 1 over epsilon of this and epsilon of that. So this is less than 1 over epsilon, the integral over e of the square of this. And the square of this is the same as the square of this. I mean, it's the same as this. I mean, there is a square outside, but the square outside and inside are comparable up to constant. So the sum of lambda I minus 1 square over lambda n plus epsilon, and then you have the square of this, which is lambda n. Okay? And, okay, so now this term we know is controlled by delta. So this term we know to control. What can we say about this? Well, the good thing here is that I can do the following. Just subtract 1, and I re-add it. Right? So I just do a trivial inequality, triangle inequality. So I just subtract 1, and then I re-add the term. And now this, for sure, is less than this. Because here I have the sum of all of them. Here I just have the last. So this is less than the sum of lambda I minus 1. So what am I saying? I'm saying that the integral over e of the sum lambda I minus 1 is less or equal than 1 over epsilon square root, delta, here delta, up to constant. So constant over epsilon delta k of e plus epsilon times the same quantity. Plus epsilon, measure of E is 1, so epsilon. Okay, now if epsilon is small, I can just take this on the other side. Right, I can reabsorb this with this term. And now, and then I optimize in epsilon. So I just first take the other one, so I get 1 half integral of E over E of sum of lambda I minus 1 is less or equal than constant. And then I have delta K over epsilon plus epsilon. And now this is equal to constant square root of delta k of e if we choose epsilon equals square root of delta k of e. So that's the best choice I can do. So that's my epsilon. So up to here it was free. This was true for every positive epsilon, but then I choose epsilon to be the square root of delta. So what I discover is that square root of delta controls this quantity. So let me probably write that down. And what is this quantity? This is the distance between the eigenvalues of my matrix and 1. So this is exactly the L1 distance between the hessian of phi and 1. So maybe let me cancel this. And I'm going to call a new, I'm going to write a new inequality, which is going to be 2 prime. So inequality 2, information 2 was this. Now 2 prime, new information. Constant square root of delta k of e is greater or equal than the integral over e of the distance between grad t minus the identity. This is hessian of phi, the same as hessian. Because, I mean, point-wise, this is a norm. I mean, the sum of the eigenvalues is controlling exactly how far is this symmetric matrix to this symmetric matrix. I can do this because these are symmetric metrics. So controlling the eigenvalues controls all the metrics. If it was not symmetric, I would have problems. So it is crucial that I have symmetry. So this is my new information. So you see in the previous case, what we said is that if delta is zero, the gradient of t is the identity. Here, if we're saying if delta is small, the square root of delta controls the L1 norm of the gradient from the identity. Okay, now what I did before, I said the gradient is the identity, so t is a translation. There was the alpha, but alpha is 1 now. So if gradient t is the identity, was exactly the identity, you'll say t is a translation. Problem, so because this is, okay, let me maybe say, so this is what? This is the integral of e of gradient of the map t of x minus x. You can see in this way. That's the same. So up to now, I'm controlling the gradient of t minus x. And I would like to control t minus x. I would like to say that the transport map is very close to be a to be the identity map after translation. OK, so what do I need? You know that some function has very small gradient on a set. And you would like to say that the function is small on that set. So this can recall to us what we did also this morning, kind of a Poincaré inequality. The gradient controls the function. So I'm going to write two inequalities here. The first one that comes to your, I mean, at least they come to my mind, when you have this and you would like to control the transport, so possible inequalities. Inequalities. I'm going to write two. So the first one is Poincaré, which tells the following, that if you have a function, so if let's say you have a set E, and you take the gradient of F, okay, here you have some assumption on E now, so it's going to be greater than a constant that I'm going to call CP of E, the constant will depend on E, the integral of F minus its average. So Poincaré inequality tells you your function, the gradient of the function controls how far your function is from the average with a constant which depends on E. You take any book, it will tell you if you have a Lipschitz connected domain, you have a Poincaré inequality. Second possible, which is another one. So here I have an information on T on the boundary of E. So if I want to put this information together with this, maybe I could try to use this to get some information on the boundary. How can I do this with what is called a trace inequality? Trace inequality tells you that the gradient of F inside controls, so I'm going to call it CT of E, how far the function is on the boundary from its average. So it's like a control of F on the boundary of the domain. So this is what is called a trace inequality. So you go to the boundary. In general, this inequality is stronger. because you are getting information on a lower dimensional set. So it's a stronger information. So here are two possible inequalities. And since here I have t on the boundary, I'm gonna apply the trace one. So let's combine 2 prime plus trace to get the following, that there is a constant, and now here come the, so there is a constant c square root of delta k of e is greater or equal, so I'm going to apply this to each comp to this function, to the t of x minus x, and then you get here c t of e integral over the boundary of t minus x. So here you should add a translation, so here really would be plus the average, so another vector. But let me write directly this up to a translation of e. What am I saying? I'm saying, okay, my transport map must be the identity plus a translation. Okay, either I keep the translation here, or I can just take my set at the very beginning and translate it back. And then I kill the translation in the transport map. So up to a translation of, I mean, it's very elementary, but I don't want to enter having an x dot everywhere because it just mess up things. So it's clear that if the transport map is a translation, I can just kill it at the very beginning by putting my set already in another position, because I always move my set around. So let's say that here we have this information. And let me move on. So now I say I have this that I'm going to call 2 second, and I have 1. Let's put 1 and 2 together, 1 and 2 seconds together. So 1 plus 2 seconds, just use triangle inequality. You get that delta k of e plus constant over CTE delta k of e with a square root is greater or equal than t minus x. Here there is another thing. Okay, so here I have a priori I have the Euclidean norm, but all the norms in Rn are equivalent. So instead of the Euclidean norm, I can use my norm up to constant. So here I put my norm. Here I use that these and these are equivalent. These will put constant which may depend on k. But at the moment, I don't want to, as long as these are universal constants, and, you know, they don't depend on E. So I can put here the other norm, and then I put this one. And here I'm going to also use that, okay, this is the dual norm on the unit normal, of the Euler normal. So this is, these are, all these vectors are on the sphere. So the norm on the sphere is going to be bounded from above and from below. So this is bounded between two constants, this number. So here use this, and use also the new E star is bounded by some constant positive. So I can get rid of this, and then I put 1 minus t. Actually, I can put just the modulus, because t is less or equal than 1. I mean, also here, I could put the modulus, right? Because this is a non-negative quantity. T is less or equal than 1. I should have put the modulus from the beginning. Okay? Please interrupt me if there is something that you don't see. I mean, I'm just using elementary fact now. In a sense, if you were in the Euclidean case, I wouldn't even worry about this. But really, I'm just using that the norms are equivalent, this norm is bounded from above and below, and stuff like that. And now you're there, and you just say, okay, let's apply triangle inequality. So trivial triangle inequality tells me, first of all, that this is, so let me copy first this, and then the modulus of the difference is greater than the difference on the modulus. So this is norm of t minus norm of x. And then triangle inequality, I can get rid of the t. So this is greater than the integral of the boundary of E of norm of x minus 1. So I just used twice triangle inequality. So what did I discover? Did I discover, okay, this you can even forget because square, delta is small, so square root is, of course, this can be absorbed in this. Square root of delta times a constant, which I'm gonna come back to, controls this, this quantity. And this quantity, what is this? Let me draw a picture. So let's say that this is my set K. And now I have my set E. So this is the origin, let's say, and I take a point on the boundary, x, which is there. I take this line. So k is the unit ball. So here on the boundary, norm is equal to 1. This point has norm 1. And this, so if you want, normal, so this, what is this length? This is norm 1, so up to constant, so Euclidean distance is comparable to the norm distance, they're all up to dimensional constant. This is comparable to this. So norm of x minus 1 is up, roughly speaking, this length. Right? And so what am I doing here? I'm integrating on the boundary norm of x minus 1. So for every direction, I'm integrating this length as x varies on the boundary. And so it's not difficult to convince itself that this controls E delta k. Oops, sorry. Once you integrate here, you get exactly the volume of all these regions up to constants. OK? I hope it's convincing enough. Because x minus 1 is exactly this length. And then you just move x around. And when x is here, you move, well, you move there. Well. There is a Jacobian factor to be careful of, but it works, believe me. So there is the argument, I mean, it's a bit technical because you have to compute exactly the Jacobian factor, but geometrically it's very obvious that it has to work because x minus 1 is exactly measuring this length. And then you're just integrating over the boundary. So what would you get? And for every E, I prove the following. E delta K up to a translation. There is a translation. Bounded by constant, which depends only on the dimension and K. Delta K of E, right? C T of E. Okay, so this is, could be think nice, but actually this is not what I wanted. Because what I proved is that square root of delta controls E delta K with a constant which depends on E itself. I mean, this is not great. I mean, the cost depends on the set. And in particular, I can give you tons of example set where that constant is just plus infinity. No, plus infinity. Yeah, denominator is zero, so that is plus infinity. And actually, I'm gonna show you right now what are our enemies. So, here is the problem. The constant depends on E. I wanted a constant depending only on the dimension. Okay, but what are our enemies? So in I will 5 minutes and we're done. Just I'm sorry that time should be over now, but I'm gonna take 5 more minutes. So what are our enemies? There are two different enemies. So let me go again to the inequality, CT. So trace. So you want to see, you want to look at whether this inequality, you want an inequality like this. This is E. This boundary V of F minus the average of F over the boundary. Okay? Okay, first enemy. E disconnected. This is CT of E is zero. If you have two connected components, you get zero. Why? Because you can always do in such, you can put two constants. So you take F equal alpha and F equal minus beta. And you choose alpha and beta in such a way that the average is zero. And then the average is zero. So the gradient is going to be zero. But then this integral is not zero. Right? The integral of modulus of F is not zero. So I can always make the average zero. This has gradient zero inside E. But this is not zero. So this is our first enemy. When E is disconnected, you don't have any trace constant. So that inequality is completely empty. I mean, this is just plus infinity. I didn't prove anything. Second bad case is this one. You take a smooth set, even very close to a ball, and then you assume that it has a kind of a cusp, like this. In this case, you can construct examples. So maybe let me blow it up here. I mean, let me do a bigger picture. So the boundary looks like this. You can take a function f, which is like f equals 0, very like equals 0, f equal 1 here. And then you, like a smooth interface, like it goes very smoothly from 0 to 1. And then roughly speaking, the gradient is going to be all concentrated in something like this. And then here on the boundary term, you will have an integral over this. And you can check that. The point is that this length is much, much smaller than this. And this is like the gradient term, and this is the right-hand side. And so you can make, if this is a cusp, like all the continuous, you can make the ratio between this length and this as small as you want. And so you contradict the inequality. So by taking a sequence of function f, which are zero on a like goes from zero to one very rough, very fast on a very small piece, you show that CT, again, is zero. So this is another bad case. But we have a hope. So hope is the following. If you give me a set and you start to make kind of the set bad, so you start to add cusps around, so this will be your enemy, every time you add a cusp, you pay perimeter. It costs you perimeter to draw a cusp. So you think, how many cusps can I have? Okay, the cusp could be infinite. I can always make infinite many cusps, very small. But every time there is a cusp, this area cannot be that huge, because if I have a very big cusp, every time I pay a certain amount of perimeter. So the idea is that, okay, maybe I can cut them away. And after I cut them away, I have a nicer set. So let me state the reduction lemma. So there exists delta n, depending only on the dimension, positive, and actually is explicit, such that if delta k of v is less or equal than delta n, then the following is true. There exists a subset G. I call it G because G is good. It's a good set such that the three following properties are true. So the measure of E minus G is very small, constant delta K of E. The deficit of G is controlled by the deficit of E. And key property, the trace constant of G is bounded from below by a dimensional constant, Cn. So the set G is done in this way. When maybe you had also multiple connected components in E, You just throw them away, you cut all the cusps, and you get a set G. And what I'm claiming is that this set G is almost full measure. You are cutting a very little fraction of it by doing this. You control this by the deficit. So the deficit tells you how much mass G could have. The deficit is still controlled by delta K, and the constant now is universal in G. So G has a universal trace constant. 1 minute, and I finish. So now what you do? You go back to to the proof I just gave, but instead of applying the proof to E, apply it to G. So by the previous proof, proof applied to G, what we get is that G delta K is bounded by constant divided by now by the trace constant of G, square root of delta K of G. But now the trace constant of G is bounded from below by a dimensional constant. So this is bounded by universal constant. And in addition, delta K of G is bounded by delta K of E. So square root of delta K of E. So this is just from the previous proof, and this is from the lemma that I just stated. And now I use that, now I just do triangle inequality. E delta K is less or equal than E minus G plus G delta K. E minus G is controlled by the deficit, constant delta K of E. And G delta K is controlled by constant square root of delta K of E. And so the sum of the two is giving a square root. Because delta is small, so this term is controlled by the square root. And so this is the proof of the inequality with a general constant. So the only thing I didn't prove to you is this reduction lemma. This lemma is kind of a bit tricky, but it's based on a kind of... The very beginning, when we first gave a proof, was based on kind of a Zorn-type argument. We said, let's take the worst, the largest set inside E, for which, in some sense, so in some sense, we looked what it means not to satisfy, so we take a set, subset of E, and we think, okay, what does it mean that this subset does not satisfy the trace inequality? And so these are the sets that we don't like. And then we take the smallest possible one, if you want, or the complement, if you want, is the largest possible one in volume. We, at the beginning, we used a Zorn-type lemma, then we removed it. But we took a maximal one. And then we proved that the maximal set actually has to satisfy this property. And it's based on the kind of elementary argument, but is a bit long. So I don't want to enter into this. But so modulo this reduction lemma, you see that the proof is at the end, and modulo the fact that I skipped every technical point about regularity. But this is the full stability result for the anisotropic case. So I'm completely out of time, so I stop here. I apologize for the delay.